Okay, hi, thank you. This is a joint work with Nir, Iftach, and Ilan. And first, thank you all for staying for the last talk of the conference. I really appreciate it. So this is a talk about hashing, and I want to start this talk with my favorite quote. Ask less of a hash function, and it's less likely to disappoint you. Okay, this is Belara Rogoway. And the meaning is that there is no right notion of the security of a hash function, and this really depends on the application. So we have a lot of applications of hash functions, and for each you can get the application with different notion of security. So let's start with the most basic notion of security. Okay, I assume most of you have seen something like this. This is a collision-resistant hash function, a CRH. So this is going to be a family of hash functions, H, okay? So we have a family of functions. Each function in the family is, so you can efficiently sample a function from the family. The functions are efficiently computable. They have to be compressing, okay? If your hash function is not compressing, maybe that's not a too big challenge. And what is the security? So the security is formalized with this game. Okay, with this very simple game, we have a challenger. He just sends a random H from the family, and the adversary needs to return X1 and X2. And we say that the adversary wins if H of X1 equals H of X2, and of course, they are different, okay? They're not the same value. So this is the standard notion of a collision-resistant hash. Okay, I want to talk about distributional collision-resistant hash. So this was a notion first defined by Dubrov and Ishai. So we still have this family of hash functions, okay? And it's still efficiently sampleable and computable. Notice that here you can talk about compressing, but actually it makes sense even to talk about non-compressing functions as long as they have some collisions, okay? And we'll see. And the security requirement is different. So the game looks very similar. We send H, and the adversary needs to response with X1 and X2, okay? But now he wins if this pair X1 and X2 is actually a random collision. So not an arbitrary collision, but a random collision. And I'm gonna explain what I mean by this. So think of the formal mental experiment, okay? I'm defining some random variable, call H. It samples a uniform random X1, okay? So X1 is uniformly at random. Then I'm gonna sample X2 conditioned on colliding with X1. So X2 is going to be uniform from all the pre-images of H of X1. And then I'm going to output X1, X2. This is what I'm going to call a random collision. Okay, you can notice that X1 might equal X2. Okay, this might happen, depends on the size of the pre-image of X1. And now, we're going to say that a family H is a distributional collision-resistant hash function, if no adversary can come close to sampling a random collision, we're close is close to this distribution. So there must exist some polynomial such for every adversary, these two distributions are 1/poly apart. So the distribution of a random collision and the distribution that the adversary can output. Okay, so going back, the definition here is that X1 and X2, he wins if they are close in statistical distance to this random collision. Okay, so this is a much harder task for the adversary, and this primitive is much weaker. So a few fun facts about DCRH, distributional CRH. So first I want to introduce in a very different context of the randomness complexity of sampling, efficient sampling, as I said by Dubrov and Ishai, a long time ago already, 2006. And you can say that they are not very collision resistant, okay? These are very weak security notion. In particular, it might be possible that you have an algorithm that can sample from the set of all collisions, okay? So this algorithm can find all collisions in this hash function, just not in the uniform distribution, so with some skewed distribution, And this algorithm still doesn't break the security of the hash function. Okay, so it's a very weak definition of security. It's analogous to, if you know, the distributional version of one-way functions. And actually also implies distributional one-way functions, where the adversary needs to not only find an arbitrary inverse of the one-way function, but a random inverse of the one-way function. And Pagliazzo and Luby showed that these two notions are actually existential equivalent. So the existence of one implies the existence of the other. And this seems not to be the case with collision-resistant hashing. They are actually black box separated from one-way functions or even one-way permutations and even one-way permutations with indistinguishability obfuscation. And the proof is very simple. Take any black box separation that you know that separates a CRH from something, and you just observe that it actually separates a DCRH from the same primitive. So the same black box separations that work for CRH, the oracle there actually samples a random collision and not an arbitrary collision. So they just work as is. Okay, so let's try to put some map of what we know. So we have DCRH now, this is the focus, is in the center of this map. And trivially, if you have a CRH, this implies a DCRH. So if you cannot find any collision, you cannot find a random collision, this is trivial. And as we said, they imply one-way functions, and this dotted line means that they're actually black box separated from one-way functions. Okay, in a previous work with Ilan, we talked about this notion of multi-collision resistant hash that in the quantum session yesterday they talked about also, where the task is to actually find k distinct elements that all hash to the same value. And we showed that you cannot build a DCRH from an MCRH in a black box manner, and then we also gave a construction that is non-black box. In the same work, we also gave a construction from SZK. This is statistical zero knowledge. I'm not going to define it. It's not too important for this talk. But we also gave a DCRH from SZK. So we have all these constructions of DCRH, and this makes sense because they have such a weak security. And the question is, what can we get from a DCRH? What meaningful application can we get from this weak definition of the security of a hash function? Okay, so we ask the question, does the power of distributional collision-resistant hash go beyond one-way functions? And the answer is yes. And that's it. No, okay. So our main result. So we show that DCRH implies a constant round, statistically hiding commitment scheme. Okay, so these are commitment schemes where are performed in a constant many rounds, and they're statistically hiding. Okay, so the receiver, even an unbounded receiver, cannot know what the message is. And since our reduction is actually black box, this shows that the power of DCRH goes beyond one-way functions because of a previous result of Haitner et al. Showing that you cannot get constant round statistically hiding commitments from one-way functions in a black box manner. To complement this result, we show that if you have a two-message statistically hiding commitment scheme, this actually implies a DCRH. Okay, so this is a very weak equivalence of these commitment schemes and DCRH. So let's go back to our picture and make it more complicated. Okay, we have this constant round commitments. So this is this work, and we also have this black box separation. We have two message commitments, okay, that imply DCRH. And now if this is not complicated enough, let's add some more errors. Okay, so from CRH, we already know how to build two round statistically hiding commitments. In some previous work, it was shown that MCRH can actually be used to construct constant round commitments. And as you can see, we get actually a new corollary. So from statistical zero knowledge, you get DCRH, and then you get constant round commitments. So we get this corollary that statistical zero knowledge implies constant round commitments. Now, some of you might be puzzled at this point. Okay, so this is our formal corollary, and ask, wait, wasn't this thing known already? So it has been regarded in some previous work, which I won't name, as a folklore result. But actually, we looked very hard, and we could not find any published proof of this corollary. The closest you can get is a paper by Ong Vadan, who showed that statistical zero knowledge imply instance-dependent commitments. These are commitments that are either statistically hiding or statistically binding, depending on the instance. And additionally, we give a direct proof of this corollary that doesn't go through the DCRH, okay? Really a direct construction from SDK to commitments, constant round commitments. Okay, so what is the outline of what I want to show? So SDK implies DCRH, this was known already. In a paper by Haitner and Al, they introduced this notion of inaccessible entropy that I'm going to talk about. And they show that if you have inaccessible entropy, you get constant round statistically hiding commitments. So the missing link is actually showing that DCRH implies this notion of inaccessible entropy. And in addition, we have this direct proof that doesn't go through this long line of reductions. Okay, so I want to introduce this notion of inaccessible entropy. And I'll do this by this example. The notion is a bit complicated. You'll just see an example, and I hope you understand. So how would I get a commitment scheme for a CRH? So this is very easy. The receiver just sends the hash function. I'm going to send a hash of this random value x. And this is going to be a commitment to this x. And it's not completely hiding X, but it's a short commitment, and it's known how to get statistic hiding commitments for a short commitment. So let's just focus on the short commitment. And then to open, I just reveal this message X. This is a very trivial scheme. Okay, and to see the binding, it's very easy. You know, the adversary cannot open to two different X's, otherwise he found a collision. What happens now if I replace this hash function with a distributional CRH. So the adversary can not only open to some x prime, he can actually open to all the x primes that are a preimage of h of x. Okay, so you really get no security at all in this scheme. But still, we claim that there is some form of weak binding here. And so I'm going to assume throughout that this function h is regular, meaning every image has the same number of pre-images. This is just for the simplicity of me presenting it. So if h of x was uniform, then the adversary cannot open to a uniform x. Because if h of x is uniform and he opened to a uniform x, he actually found a uniform collision, a random collision. So we do have some weak notion of binding here. And in particular, the adversary must choose between two types of entropy loss. Either he has entropy loss in the first method, and he doesn't send a uniform y, or he has entropy loss in the second method, where he doesn't send a uniform x, a uniform that is conditioned on colliding with y. Okay, and this exactly is captured by this notion of inaccessible entropy. So the idea is we have this generator. We have some polynomial time algorithm that's going to generate outputs. And we say that we have inaccessible entropy if the real entropy, okay, meaning the entropy that an outside observer sees, is going to be bigger than the accessible entropy of the generator. And to explain this, let's see an example. So I have this generator. And it gets this hash function h. Let's just assume these are public parameters. I'm not going to count this in the entropy. So it samples a random x, and it outputs h of x. This is y. Okay, and then it samples x. What is the entropy of this generator? Okay, from somebody that looks outside at the output of this generator. So we have the entropy of the first message, okay, plus the entropy of x conditioned on the previous message, okay, in the previous block. So the first y is just n minus k bits, okay, because we assume this is random. And then x conditioned on y is additional x bits, and we get the n bits of entropy. If you look at the if h is collision resistance, and you look from the perspective of this generator g, even a cheating generator g, then once he outputted y, there is no more entropy in x. Okay, so he has the entropy on the first message, but conditioned on what he knows already, there's no entropy for the second message that can be consistent pre-image. So this means that even if you take a... 3 minutes, okay. Even if you take a cheating generator, no matter it has samples some randomness S1 and outputs some Y, I don't know what he did, maybe he didn't sample an X and output H of X. Okay, and then he uses some randomness S2 and outputs some X that is in the pre-image of Y. Then the real entropy is the same, okay, but the accessible entropy now is the entropy of Y, the entropy of Y, plus the entropy of X conditioned on Y and the randomness S1, okay, and this is the crucial part. And for any efficient generator, there's no more entropy for the second. If I conditioned on the randomness of the first message, the second message has no more entropy. And this is why we have inaccessible entropy. And really now, just to close the proof, let's replace the CRH with DCRH. Okay, and we see that still the real entropy is exactly the same. But now we have some weak notion of inaccessible entropy. Because from a cheating G, X can be quite random, but it has to be still statistically far from Y. And Y is a random pre-image. And if you're statistically far from a random variable, then you have less entropy than this. If you're statistically far from a uniformly random variable, you have less entropy than this random variable. Okay, and this is actually the heart of the proof is showing this. The proof is a bit technical, uses tools from information theory. There's a big difference between we have to deal with Shannon entropy as opposed to a CRH or MCRH, which have a guarantee on the max entropy. So I don't have much time, I'm gonna skip this. So the second result is two matches statistically hiding commitments implied DCRH. I don't have much time, so I'm going to skip the proof. The proof is quite easy. And I just want to conclude with some open problems. So different notions of collision resistance imply different notions of inaccessible entropy. If you have a CRH, you really have zero max entropy, just the support of X's that you can open to after you committed to Y is only the same X that you chose. So really you have zero max entropy, okay? Yeah, you can maybe guess, so it's close to zero, but it's negligible. If you have, and then you get succinct two round commitment schemes, okay? So these are statistically hiding commitments. They're also succinct, they're very small, much shorter than what you want to commit to. And these have many applications. If you have a MCRH, a multi-collision resistant hash, then the adversary might be able to open to X1, X2, X3, X4, but he has some finite list. Okay, so still you have some strong guarantee on the support size of what he can open to, and this gives you a strong guarantee on the max entropy, that it's not zero, but it's quite small. And we have shown in previous work that this is actually also implies a short commitment scheme. It's now not two messages, it's going to be constant messages. If you go below this line, you have a DCRH, which implies the most weakest notion of entropy. It's almost maximal, just a bit less than maximal, and this is Shannon entropy. And in this work, we show that this implies a constant round commitment scheme, but not succinct. And there's two main open questions here. First, you can go over this scale and see what different notions of hash gives you different notions of entropy and what applications you can get from each such notion. And the second question is, where is this line? What is the minimal a security requirement on a hash that you can get succinct constant round commitments. Okay, thanks.
Do you have any questions? So maybe I have a quick
question. People want to go home. So.
No, not yet. So if you have a DCRH, this in particular means that you cannot enumerate always all collisions, right? Because otherwise I could just output all collisions and pick a random one. So that would be a DCRH. So doesn't that mean that it's in some sense like a bound, you know, MCRH already, because you can only output?
You can't really enumerate over all of them. You can sample from all of them, but not with the right distribution. So
yeah, but in particular, you cannot enumerate. And if you cannot enumerate all, say, 2 to the k collisions, it means...
So what is it? You cannot specify I and get, like, the ith collision. This is something...
But if k is small, then, okay, then it's a MCRH where you cannot output all 2 to the k collisions, only 2 to the k minus 1, and then...
I'm not sure.
Probably doesn't exist. Okay. Yeah.
So I think you have many collisions, okay? Like, you need to sample over all x and then all pre-images. So it's not just a fixed y and then just enumerate over all pre-images.
Okay. Yevgeny?
I mean, this is very elegant, and I assume, I mean, please tell me if I'm wrong, that currently we don't probably have, like, some natural hardness assumption or a problem which is believed to be DCRH, but is, like, definitely not CRH. Is there some direction or some kind of notion of some variant of collision resistance?
What do you mean? We have, like,
we do?
SDK implies DCRH, and it's not known to know to imply any other form of hash.
As a complexity class. But I'm saying, do we actually have, like, some construction relatively, maybe, I don't know if relatively natural or not, but something which is...
SDK is my best example. You know, from DDH and stuff like that, we know how to build CRH.
Right. But this SDK, you're saying, does it give you at least some theoretical kind of construction, which is believed to be, I mean, from which we... So you're saying SDK in general? I'm just trying to see if it gives...
There exists a hard on average problem in SDK, when you have this DCRH, and I think...
So saying that does
I don't think it applies CRH, like, we're far from that.
I was just saying, in general, along these directions, I mean, to me, it would be interesting to kind of see, I don't know, assumption, but some kind of, you know, hash functions are really hard to construct, at least with kind of provable security. Is there some kind of notion or direction, I don't know if it's DCRH or something, where maybe it's guided by practice, where there are some kind of designs which need to be much harder to be collision resistant, but might be good enough for some hardness?
Yeah, okay, yeah, that might be possible.
Okay, so if there are no more questions, let's thank the speakers of this session and also the organizers, so Mark Fishtin and his team, and the PC and the program chairs. Let's give them a round of applause and see you next year.